changes that you saw last year, probably in the neighborhood of $400 million over 6 years. That's some pretty significant savings. And the Finance Committee will make sure and hold them to that, to those savings. And there were other savings that were put in place as well. So I think that's the thing, is all we can hope to do is execute and do what we do and then hand off to the next people that sit at these seats a plan. If they follow it, we would hope that they would, but it certainly will be up to them. Matt? And I think Shoni.
Matt Buxton, Fairbanks Daily News Miner. Senator Michiki, you talked a little bit about, I just wanted to get some clarification on what you said about, it sounds like a hold or something on non-budgetary legislation. Is that what the plan is, or is there just kind of, I guess, how do you approach what kind of bills might be heard that are not budget related? Is there kind of a, I think the House last year had that hashtag all about the budget thing. We saw how that worked out. Is that what you guys were looking at this year?
So I guess the way I'd start that is the Senate doesn't operate with rhetorical sort of boutique statements on what we're going to or not going to do, but we are focused on solving the fiscal gap first. It's our first priority. If I, and we'll talk a little bit more about the football field concept later of what we plan to get done this year, but if I was going to put it in proportional status, 90% of our concern is going to be getting out the gate first and solving our fiscal gap issues. So we are not prioritizing personal legislation. I've got some of my own. It's taking a distant back seat to moving forward very quickly and very carefully on how we're going to solve this issue. And Senator Hoffman talked a little bit about business as usual. I mean, it has not worked for us. We are going to push aside some of the typical ways that we do business, where you start storing up pet bills early in the session, thinking about how you're going to negotiate later. We're focused on the budget, and everything else takes a distant second place or back seat.
Shauna?
Yes, you said, Shauna Crandall, Alaska Education Update, you said that you will be looking at the big items in terms of fiscal responsibility, health and social services, education, DOT, and
university.
What specifically are you going to look at for education? Are you going to open up the formula?
Go ahead.
Well, as I said, we don't have specifics at this point, you know, but when you look at the department's budgets, I don't know if I brought that sheet with me, but those four far exceed all of the other smaller departments. So it's hard to achieve the numbers of $300 million without addressing those four elephants in the room. So what we're going to do, and the committee process on how we get there still has to be determined. We're not saying that this what has to be addressed, or this what is what has to be addressed, or this is what has to be addressed. We know there is a fiscal problem, and the in order to achieve the $300 million, it's the big four that is where the spend is.
James.
James Brooks from the Juneau Empire. Last year, the Senate passed Senate Bill 128. And then again this year, I believe your goals had said there was some sort of permanent fund draw that you were looking at doing. I was curious, will we see a version of SB 128? Are you looking at a different way to do things? What should we expect to see, and when should we see it?
Well, and number one, the fiscal situation is the situation that we're going to be most concentrating on. And evaluating the use of the earnings reserve is going to be part of our process. We don't know exactly what that's going to look like at the end. Last year, it became there were so many competing plans. The governor's plan. We spent a great deal of time reviewing his plan and presenting it to the people of Alaska. Ultimately, the Senate came out with a different version, and then the House didn't pass it at all. evaluating the use of the earnings reserve is going to be part of our plan. To say SB 128 again, I don't think we're going to do that because we just can't predict that at this point. But I know the governor is going to be concentrating on it. I've been told that members of the leadership and the other body are concentrating on it. We're not going to speak for them, and we are looking at it as well. Let's see. Hi.
Rasha McChesney, KTOO. I'm wondering what you think of the fact that Governor Walker left an $890 million hole in the budget, and if you intend on filling it with cuts or if you're open to new sources of revenue, and if you are, which ones?
Senator McKinnon, you want to?
Well, I'm going back to the other question first. James, we have a new leadership team. We have a new Senate with new members that will offer a variety of solutions and new ideas, and then a new House. And so we want to hear from the House on Senator Kelly's point as to how they would solve the problem. Again, all things are on the table. Rasha, could you restate?
Sure. I'm wondering what you think of the fact that the governor left that $890 million hole in the budget and how you would fill it.
Thank you. The budgets that this administration has brought forward typically are not what we're used to seeing, and so it doesn't surprise us that there's a large hole, and we will probably fill it differently. But again, we're trying to reach out to the administration. Senator Kelly and I, as co-chairman, reached out to the administration back in October multiple times to come to the table and talk about our desire to have some targeted cuts that would help lower the budget and not come in fighting about this. And so I think we're approaching it in the same way. The governor may think that an income tax or a sales tax is worth a conversation. The Senate may not. We have vocal members in opposition, and we have members that may be supportive. So it's okay that the hole is there. We're looking for those structural changes in our budget. And we're starting at least the conversation with a spending cap, and it's going to the devil's in the details. We really need to know how a spending cap will work, both for agencies, for the legislature, for the court system, and for the people of Alaska. So, you know, we don't want to get it wrong. So I think that will be a careful conversation, but the spending limit is our focus, or mine as the co-chairman of the capital budget, and then responsible for those bills. We're looking at the spending limit conversation, but we'll fill the hole. It will be a combination, I suspect, of budget cuts and some revenue.
And just in Daniel, if I could just in general, not necessarily answering a specific question here, but the spending limit, the budget reductions, and we will evaluate the use of the earnings reserve, but we are not going to act on the earnings reserve until there is a spending limit written in place and proven reductions. I think that's something we all agree on. We don't know exactly what the form this is all going to take here on the first day of session. But that is something we're pretty committed to, is those two things at least have to be in place. Daniel, what were you saying? Wrap it up. Someone say that's in here that I can understand what he just. Okay. Let's see. Let's start from the beginning again. Back to Becky.
Becky Board, the Associated Press. Senator Kelly, you'd mentioned the $4.3 billion that we're at now, but we have a bit of a backlog in tax credits that are obligated. Mm-hmm. They were deferred with the governor's veto. And I'm curious if the Senate is open to a discussion on further work on oil tax credits, and if there's been discussion on whether the majority supports the governor's pay the statutory minimum or trying to pay off that obligation as soon as possible.
The unfortunate thing is we had the money from 16 to pay 16's obligation, and he chose not to pay it, so that number is accruing. But before I'm going to turn it over to others to answer this question on maybe a more specific level. But as we're looking at oil taxes or oil production, oil taxes or oil tax credits, production has to be our goal. That's one of the things that was most disturbing about the administration's presentation last year, was they had page after page in PowerPoints about this kind of Rube Goldberg setup on oil tax credits and everything like that, and nothing addressed increased production. If we had a pipeline that at one point was producing 2 million barrels per day. We're not going back to that, and I'm not so naive as to think we will. However, we have to get a more oil flowing through that pipeline, and whatever actions we take can't result in less oil going through it. So I'll turn it over to others to comment on that.
I we have a couple of sort of operating tenets, and one of them is that no function or category of spend is beyond evaluation, and that includes oil taxes and credits. I mean, Senator Kelly talked about our primary objective on remaining competitive and encouraging production, but it's certainly something that we have to evaluate, especially considering the makeup of the House, right? So when we talked about finding commonality, there are going to be areas where we don't agree, but it's in order to get a full package on the table and supported and out the door in a 90-day session or so, that's a consideration we're going to have to take. And just partially, I don't want to go back on an answer with another person that asked a question, but partially to Rasha's question, I think it's strategic for the governor to leave a gap. I think he tried to propose something the last 2 years that would have filled the gap, and it seemed like it came to the point of where anything that came from the administration took so much time to process that we got nowhere. I think in a way, sort of saying, all right, what do you have in mind? And could it be more successful getting through this legislature? And to that, I think we're open, and I think we're going to have some fresh ideas that will deal with not only the $3.2 billion remaining gap, but also that $800 million that remains in the budget for a whole.
And Daniel's telling me we've got one more question. Go, but before, Senator Meyer.
As you recall from last year, Becky, and by the way, it's good to see a lot of the same press back again. That helps for the continuity. But if you recall last year, our plan was pretty simple, the three R's, and the Senate implemented that plan very successfully. We had the reductions. We had to give some up during the three-quarter vote. And we did the reforms. If you recall, most of the reforms were Senate bills, Senate Bill 91, Senate Bill 74, Medicaid, and we were prepared to also do a Senate bill for oil and gas tax credits. Senator Giesel had a bill ready, but we said the House has to do something. And if you recall, the House, it took them a long time, but they finally did send over a tax credit reform bill. And then finally, the revenue was also a Senate bill. So we feel like the last couple years we've taken the lead, and as my colleagues have mentioned, we're now going to work with the House, work with the governor, but kind of wait and see what they're going to send us.
As far as the mechanics dealing on the budget between the House and the Senate, last year we put out a Senate budget bill on day 45 of the session. We've never even been close to being done with our work that early before. I think you can expect that again this year. Of course, Senator Hoffman is in control of the operating budget, and his schedule is going to be his schedule. But we have talked about getting it out early as well, leaving open the end of the session to discuss some of these larger issues. The deficits that you saw last year, probably in the neighborhood of $400 million over 6 years, that's some pretty significant savings. And the Finance Committee will make sure and hold them to that, to those savings. And there were other savings that were put in place as well. So I think that's the thing, is all we can hope to do is execute and do what we do, and then hand off to the next people that sit at these seats a plan. If they follow it, we would hope that they would, but it certainly will be up to them. Matt? And I think Shoni.
Matt Buxton, Fairbanks Daily Newsminer. Senator Michiki, you talked a little bit about, I just wanted to get some clarification on what you said about, it sounds like a hold or something on non-budgetary legislation. Is that what the plan is, or is there just kind of, I guess, how do you approach what kind of bills might be heard that are not budget related? Is there kind of a, you know, I think the House last year had that hashtag all about the budget thing. We saw how that worked out. Is that what you guys were looking at this year?
So I guess the way I'd start that is the Senate doesn't operate with rhetorical sort of boutique statements on what we're going to or not going to do, but we are focused on solving the fiscal gap first. It's our first priority. If I, and we'll talk a little bit more about the football field concept later of what we plan to get done this year, but if I was going to put it in proportional status, 90% of our concern is going to be getting out the gate first and solving our fiscal gap issues. So we are not prioritizing personal legislation. I've got some of my own. It's taking a distant back seat to moving forward very quickly and very carefully on how we're going to solve this issue. And Senator Hoffman talked a little bit about business as usual. I mean, it has not worked for us. We are going to push aside some of the typical ways that we do business, where you start storing up pet bills early in the session, thinking about how you're going to negotiate later. We're focused on the budget, and everything else takes a distant second place or back seat.
Shauna?
Yes, you said, Shauna Crandall, Alaska Education Update, you said that you will be looking at the big items in terms of fiscal responsibility, health and social services, education, DOT, and
university.
What specifically are you going to look at for education? Are you going to open up the formula?
Go ahead.
Well, as I said, we don't have specifics at this point, you know, but when you look at the department's budgets, I don't know if I brought that sheet with me, but those four far exceed all of the other smaller departments. So it's hard to achieve the numbers of $300 million without addressing those four elephants in the room. So what we're going to do, and the committee process on how we get there still has to be determined. We're not saying that this what has to be addressed, or this what is what has to be addressed, or this is what has to be addressed. We know there is a fiscal problem, and the in order to achieve the $300 million, it's the big four that is where the spend is.
James Brooks from the Juneau Empire. Last year, the Senate passed Senate Bill 128. And then again this year, I believe your goals had said there was some sort of permanent fund draw that you were looking at doing. I was curious, will we see a version of SB 128? Are you looking at a different way to do things? What should we expect to see, and when should we see it?
Well, and number one, the fiscal situation is the situation that we're going to be most concentrating on. And evaluating the use of the earnings reserve is going to be part of our process. We don't know exactly what that's going to look like at the end. Last year, it became there were so many competing plans. The governor's plan. We spent a great deal of time reviewing his plan and presenting it to the people of Alaska. Ultimately, the Senate came out with a different version, and then the House didn't pass it at all. Evaluating the use of the earnings reserve is going to be part of our plan. To say SB 128 again, I don't think we're going to do that, because we just can't predict that at this point. But I know the governor is going to be concentrating on it. I've been told that members of the leadership in the other body are concentrating on it. Not going to speak for them, and we are looking at it as well. Let's see. Hi.
Rasha McChesney, KTOO. I'm wondering what you think of the fact that Governor Walker left an $890 million hole in the budget, and if you intend on filling it with cuts, or if you're open to new sources of revenue, and if you are, which ones?
Senator McKinnon, you want to?
Well, I'm going back to the other question first. James, we have a new leadership team. We have a new Senate with new members that will offer a variety of solutions and new ideas, and then a new House. And so we want to hear from the House on Senator Kelly's point as to how they would solve the problem. Again, all things are on the table. Rasha, could you restate?
Sure. I'm wondering what you think of the fact that the governor left that $890 million hole in the budget and how you would fill it.
Thank you. The budgets that this administration has brought forward typically are not what we're used to seeing, and so it doesn't surprise us that there's a large hole, and we will probably fill it differently. But again, we're trying to reach out to the administration. Senator Kelly and I, as co-chairman, reached out to the administration back in October multiple times to come to the table and talk about our desire to have some targeted cuts that would help lower the budget and not come in fighting about this. And so I think we're approaching it in the same way. The governor may think that an income tax or a sales tax is worth a conversation. The Senate may not. We have vocal members in opposition, and we have members that may be supportive. So it's okay that the hole is there. We're looking for those structural changes in our budget. And we're starting at least the conversation with a spending cap, and it's going to the devil's in the details. We really need to know how a spending cap will work, both for agencies, for the legislature, for the court system, and for the people of Alaska. So, you know, we don't want to get it wrong. So I think that will be a careful conversation, but the spending limit is our focus, or mine as the co-chairman of the capital budget, and then responsible for those bills. We're looking at the spending limit conversation, but we'll fill the hole. It will be a combination, I suspect, of budget cuts and some revenue.
And just in Daniel, if I could just in general, not necessarily answering a specific question here, but the spending limit, the budget reductions, and we will evaluate the use of the earnings reserve, but we are not going to act on the earnings reserve until there is a spending limit written in place and proven reductions. I think that's something we all agree on. We don't know exactly what the form this is all going to take here on the first day of session. But that is something we're pretty committed to, is those two things at least have to be in place. Daniel, what were you saying? Wrap it up. Someone say that's in here that I can understand what he just said. Okay. Let's see. Let's start from the beginning again. Back to Becky.
Becky Board, the Associated Press. Senator Kelly, you'd mentioned the $4.3 billion that we're at now, but we have a bit of a backlog in tax credits that are obligated. Mm-hmm. They were deferred with the governor's veto. And I'm curious if the Senate is open to a discussion on further work on oil tax credits, and if there's been discussion on whether the majority supports the governor's pay the statutory minimum or trying to pay off that obligation as soon as possible.
The unfortunate thing is we had the money from 16 to pay 16's obligation, and he chose not to pay it, so that number is accruing. But before, I'm going to turn it over to others to answer this question on maybe a more specific level, but as we're looking at oil taxes or oil tax credits, production has to be our goal. That's one of the things that was most disturbing about the administration's presentation last year, was they had page after page in PowerPoints about this kind of Rube Goldberg setup on oil tax credits and everything like that, and nothing addressed increased production. We had a pipeline that at one point was producing 2 million barrels per day. We're not going back to that, and I'm not so naive as to think we will. However, we have to get more oil flowing through that pipeline, and whatever actions we take can't result in less oil going through it. So I'll turn it over to others to comment on that.
I clearly, so we have a couple of sort of operating tenets, and one of them is that no function or category of spend is beyond evaluation, and that includes oil taxes and credits. I mean, Senator Kelly talked about our primary objective on remaining competitive and encouraging production, but it's certainly something that we have to evaluate, especially considering the makeup of the House. Right? So when we talked about finding commonality, there are going to be areas where we don't agree, but it's in order to get a full package on the table and supported and out the door in a 90-day session or so, that's a consideration we're going to have to take. And just partially to, I don't want to go back on an answer with another person that asked a question, but partially to Rasha's question, I think it's strategic for the governor to leave a gap. I think he tried to propose something the last 2 years that would have filled the gap, and it seemed like it came to the point of where anything that came from the administration took so much time to process that we got nowhere. I think in a way sort of saying, all right, what do you have in mind? And could it be more successful getting through this legislature? And to that, I think we're open, and I think we're gonna have some fresh ideas that we'll deal with not only the $3.2 billion remaining gap, but also that $800 million that remains in the budget for a whole.
And Daniel's telling me we've got one more question. Go ahead, but before, Senator Meyer.
As you recall from last year, Becky, and by the way, it's good to see a lot of the same press back again. That helps for the continuity. But if you recall last year, our plan was pretty simple, the three R's, and the Senate implemented that plan very successfully. We had the reductions, we had to give some up during the three-quarter vote, and we did the reforms. If you recall, most of the reforms were Senate bills, Senate Bill 91, Senate Bill 74, Medicaid, and we were prepared to also do a Senate bill for oil and gas tax credits. Senator Giesel had a bill ready, but we said the House has to do something. And if you recall, the House, it took them a long time, but they finally did send over a tax credit reform bill. And then finally, the revenue was also a Senate bill. So we feel like the last couple years, we've taken the lead. And as my colleagues have mentioned, we're now going to work with the House, work with the governor, but kind of wait and see what they're going to send us.
As far as the mechanics dealing on the budget between the House and the Senate, last year we put out a Senate budget bill on day 45 of the session. We've never even been close to being done with our work that early before. I think you can expect that again this year. Of course, Senator Hoffman is in control of the operating budget, and his schedule is going to be his schedule, but we have talked about getting it out early as well, leaving open the end of the session to discuss some of these larger issues. The deficit and how we deal with it will be germinating through the first 45 days or so, and then we will be dealing between the different bodies after that. But that gives us the time to have the conversations that need to happen between the two bodies to work these deals out, rather than just at the end of the session when there's 5 days left and we're trying to deal with these monstrous issues. It doesn't work. And so we'll probably repeat what we did last year of a very early Senate budget. Again, as I said, we will deal, as we have in the past, quickly and competently on these issues, and we'll just have to let the House do what it's going to do. Daniel says I have time for one more question, and since we're just going in order, I think that it was Austin that was up.
So I wonder, of the big fiscal proposals, are there any that are non-starters with the Senate or extremely unlikely to move forward? And beyond that, is there any legislation that perhaps the rules chair wouldn't schedule or wouldn't put to a vote?
I'll let the rules chair answer that question. However, I would say that there are 20 members of the Senate, and I don't want to start speaking for them about what a non-starter is. So.
I can't think of any bills at this point in time that wouldn't go to the floor. Obviously, they have to get through the committee process. You know, if they get through the committee process and have support, then more than likely we'll put them on the floor.
That's it then, Daniel. Yeah. Thank you. Thanks a lot, guys. Good to see you back here. And where that.